Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about pole changing method of speed control. So this method can be used only for squirrel cage induction motors. So we have seen in the basics that in the case of squirrel cage induction motor, as the rotor bars are short circuited, they can easily adapt to the number of poles on the stator, but this is not the case for wound rotor type of induction motor. In the case of wound rotor motor induction motor, the number of stator poles will be maintained equal to the number of rotor poles, but in the case of squirrel cage induction motor, automatically it will be induced. So that's why even if you change the number of poles on the stator, the motor is not going to affect. Whereas if you want to apply this pole changing method for the wound rotor induction motors, you should have the flexibility in both stator and rotor, which will be very costly affair. So this method, what we are controlling by changing the number of poles, we know NS is equal to 120 f/p. By changing the number of poles, I am going to change my synchronous speed. So when the synchronous speed is changed, so N is equal to NS into 1 minus S. So as NS is changed, so N will be changed. So this is the basic technique. But the disadvantage of this technique is only we can obtain 1:2 ratio of the speeds. That means if your normal speed is NS, I can get 2 times of NS, or divide by 2. I can decrease the pole by half or increase the poles to 2 times. Only that is the basic limitation of this method. And the second method is, so this can be obtained using 2 separate windings. Because 2 different poles are required, either we can go for 2 separate windings, or we can use the method of consequent poles for getting the change in the poles. So let us see each one of them in detail now. First one, using 2 separate windings. If you are using 2 separate windings, that means in the stator I need 2 windings. So if you want to keep 2 windings, that means 2 separate windings are required. So when 2 separate windings are required, then the size of your stator increases. When the size increases, the cost increases. And obviously when the windings are more, then the maintenance also will increase. So that's why this method is not used in practice. Generally, keeping 2 separate windings is a very costly affair and very difficult task, and maintenance also. So that's why practically we always go for the method of consequent poles. Method of consequent poles. So let us see what will happen when 2 adjacent conductors are carrying current in same direction and in opposite direction. We have seen in the basics, if the current is coming towards me, I represent with the dot. If the current is going away from me, I represent with cross. So let us assume I am taking a dot, I represent the cross. So if you want to find the direction of the magnetic field produced by this, I can find using the right hand thumb rule. If you have your right hand thumb rule, the dot indicates current is coming towards me, or the thumb is pointing towards me, you will get your direction of the flux as counterclockwise direction, like this. So similarly, if you are getting the cross, that means current is going away from us, I can represent by the cross, or it will be clockwise direction. So now let us see, if 2 adjacent conductors are carrying current in the same direction, what is going to happen? So there is a conductor, first conductor and second conductor. Let us assume field produced by the first one, I am representing with in this form. So let us assume this field will expand up to infinite. So this field is expanded up to infinite in this way. So this will be the direction here, counterclockwise direction. Now because of the second conductor, let us assume the direction of the flux. Again, when I apply, I will get this as like this. So similarly, it will extend up to infinite. So I can tell that this direction of the field will be downwards like this. So you can see here, in the outer side, the fluxes are adding to each other, but inside the fluxes are opposing each other. So you can tell that in the center, the reluctance is more. Reluctance for the passage of flux is more compared to the outer side. So if you calculate the net effect of these two things, if I take these two conductors, you will observe that in the outer side, the fluxes will add, inside the flux cannot pass. So because of the reluctance, so your direction of your flux will come out to be like this. So in this way, your flux will be aligned. So you can observe here that in the center, the flux is cancelling, and the outer side, the flux is increasing, and there will be a force of attraction between these two fields, and the flux produced by the each conductor is adding in the outer side. So this is what is our observation. Let us see the another case. If 2 adjacent conductors are carrying current in opposite direction, so what is going to happen? So now I am representing for the case of dot. So this is my direction of my field, because we know it will be counterclockwise applying the right hand thumb rule. So it will be like this. So now, because of the second conductor, so the second conductor, if you apply the right hand thumb rule, you will get it as clockwise direction. So you will get it like this. So in this side, if you extend this, so you will get it in the similar way, you can get it like this. So you can see here, in the outer periphery, if you apply, you are seeing the fluxes are opposing each other. Here also the fluxes are opposing each other. One is going upwards, one is going downwards. Or we can tell the reluctance is more in the outer side when compared to the center, because in the center the reluctance is decreased or the flux is increased in the center. Or we can tell that when two conductors are carrying current in the opposite direction, in the center the flux is adding, in the outer side the flux is decreasing. So how to find the direction of this field? Again, this flux can also be found by using the right hand thumb rule in the same way. Now your fingers, curled fingers, indicates the direction of the current, thumb indicates the direction of the magnetic field. So you hold these conductors in such a way, wherever the cross is there, your fingers are going inside. Wherever dot is there, your fingers are coming towards us. In that way you hold your hand, then your thumb indicates your direction of the magnetic field. You will observe the direction of magnetic field will be like this. We know wherever the flux is coming out of the conductor, I can keep it as a north pole, because flux will always have a closed path. So this side it will be a south pole. If you are reversing the polarity, like let us assume if I am taking cross, then followed by a dot, or if I keep a dot here. So in that case, again you can apply the right hand rule. If you apply the right hand thumb rule, your curled finger will be like that. Your wherever your dot is there, the fingers comes out. So your thumb will indicate downwards, or I can tell my field will be coming like this. This will act as a north pole, this will act as a south pole. So I am going to use this principle for producing the number of poles or increasing the number of poles. So let us take for example, this is my rotor. I am taking the conductors, this is cross, this is dot. I am taking this is cross and this is dot. So remember here, this is not a single conductor, actually there is a coil. A set of coil is there, that means two adjacent conductors are carrying in such a way, because adjacent conductors, we know the flux will always add to each other. So resultant flux I am representing. So this is my conductor set A, this is A dash. So let us assume this is B and this is B dash. So automatically between these two, we have just analyzed cross followed by dot, then in between them the fold will be formed. So the flux will be formed like this, here the flux will come out. So this will act as a north pole. So here the flux will go inside, so we can tell it as a south pole, because remember here this is the stator, from the stator the flux will come out. So similarly between these two, again cross multiplied by dot, the cross and the dot, so the flux will come downwards. So again this I can take as the opposite polarity. So using this you can get, see, this is north pole, this is south pole, again north pole, again south pole. In this manner multiple number of poles can be obtained. So let us assume in the initial case number of poles is equal to 4. So now I want to decrease the number of poles. So how can I decrease? Again same thing, whatever the adjacent conductors are there, change the polarity in such a way two adjacent conductors will carry current in same direction. So now what I am doing, I am taking these two as dot and this conductor I have kept cross. So in that case what happens, the flux produced by these two will add and flux produced by these two will add. Remember this is a circular shape, I have just opened and showing you. So between these two dissimilar poles the pole will be formed. So here the flux will come out, so here the flux will go inside. So how many poles are formed in this case? Only two poles are formed. So when the poles are decreased, the speed will increase. So in this way I can get the multiple speeds, but generally this method is used only in the ratio of 1:2, because we cannot change the number of poles drastically, because the flux also depends on, because we know the flux phi is equal to MMF divided by reluctance. Generally reluctance of magnetic field is constant, it depends on MMF. MMF is nothing but N into I. So if you want to increase the number of poles, automatically number of turns are decreased. So to compensate for this, you have to increase your current. So when you are increasing the current, because we know the flux and current relationship will be like this, initially it will be linear and after that it goes to deep saturation. Already it will be operating around this region. So if you want to increase the value of the current, if you increase the current, the flux change will not be linear. To get a small change in the flux, you have to increase your current drastically, because your core goes to deep saturation. That is a limitation for this. That's why generally this method can be used only in the ratio of 1:2 ratio speeds. I hope this method is completely clear to you. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.